According to the theory of evolution, you used to be a monkey. That's not right. For one thing, you still are a monkey. It's impossible to define monkey in a way that doesn't also include apes. Also, it's not you. The tree of life doesn't include specific organisms as much as genetic lines. A species is any collection of lines close enough to mate and produce fertile offspring. Now, there are circle species which betray this definition, but science is all relative anyways. Point being, two lines can separate. That's how all life formed from the first two-dimensional array of chemical reactions. But that moment, right before a line split, there's something special there. That's the most recent common ancestor. What's fun about these is that oftentimes we have no practical knowledge of them and they have to be fully reconstructed based on what they're the ancestor of. And today, I want to shine some light on these and even rate them based on how cool they are. So let's start with Morganucodon, that is. Morgan is the common ancestor of all mammals. Not she's some reconstructed ancestor, she's a fossil. And for that reason, we can't be sure she's the last common ancestor. But she's very close. On the face of it, Morgan resembles a shrew or a rat. Though obviously she can't be a rat, her teeth don't grow back, and she can't be a shrew, she has arched cheekbones. She's just a mammal. Morganucodon lived during the late Triassic. Let's discuss features. The most significant change occurred in the jaw region. As you may know, reptiles have three jawbones and one ear bone, and mammals have one jawbone and three ear bones. It's a bit more complicated than that, and Morgan had something like two jawbones and three ear bones. Morgan is also the starting place for a lot of other mammalian features. Not hair, at least. Whiskers started well before the Triassic, and therapsids had been covered in hair for a long time. Breasts are a more difficult innovation to trace. The idea of feeding your young ones is not revolutionary, but doing it through glands on the chest is odd. A theory that holds some water is sweat glands that regulate the temperature of eggs could eventually be used for sustenance, and when we lost the eggs, we kept the sustenance. Morgan hadn't lost her eggs yet, so she was still stuck with sweaty milk. We tend to think of the Mesozoic as the age of the dinosaurs, but therapsids like Lystrosaurus, Dimetrodon, Cynognathus, and Morgan were ruling during the Triassic, along with a healthy dose of crocodilians. It was the Triassic extinction that really did pave the way for them. It destroyed any chances of the mammal lineage coming from predators or even large herbivores. The only strain of therapsid surviving was Morganucodon, a tiny nocturnal insect eater. So I think ranking her is complicated. I think it's clear she represents the platonic ideal of mammals as nocturnal insectivores, as with survivors that can outlast multiple extinctions. I know you can get mixed opinions when we're discussing a topic such as this, and it's largely a matter of preference, so I'll give it an A for however much it's worth, and move on. But mammals have competition. They always had. In the late Triassic, there was another group blossoming, the dinosaurs. The reconstructed dinosaur most recent common ancestor is not named. It seems we're right on the cusp of actually discovering that animal, and so no one feels the need to speculate. But I'm someone, so the closest animal before the split is called Marsupius, and the closest after is Eoraptor, the dawn thief. The split in question is the divide between the Ornithischians and Saurischians. Saurischians are the lizard-hip group, so named because they don't include lizards. Using the ischium to refer to the hip is a bit misleading, as it's the pubis that changes between the two clades, but whatever. Both creatures confirm lizard hips is the normal, with the pelvis on top, the ischium to the back, and the pubis out in front. The femur moves by pulling on the pubis. Besides the lizard-hipped, Ornithischians are the bird-hipped group, so named because they don't include birds. In these dinosaurs, the pelvis is on top, ischium is to the back, and so is the pubis. The femur moves forward by pulling on a process extending from the pelvis, or sometimes the pubis. Like I said, Eoraptor is lizard-hipped. Bird hips evolved at least twice in dinosaurs, once in the Ornithischians, and once in the birds. The ending root raptor conjures up images of Velociraptor, Utahraptor, Microraptor, Buitreraptor, a group called Dromaeosaurids, but Eoraptor is much too old for that. Among the Saurischians, we have another split, lizard feet and beast feet. Eoraptor confirms whether a lot of the features between these two groups were basal or derived. Eoraptor has five claws, confirming that the three-toed theropods are derived. Eoraptor also walks upright, confirming that the quadrupedal sauropods are derived. Not surprisingly, because we can see it develop with prosauropods like Massospondylus. The jury was out for a while on diet, but now it's settled on omnivore, and both paths are derived. The verdict. I don't think people care enough about this. Come on, people, are we really unwilling to reconstruct the potential common ancestor of all the dinosaurs? I guess it's up to me to defend it by giving it an 8 out of 10. So, mammals were the chosen clades of the synapsids, dinosaurs the chosen of the sauropsids. Amniotes. We'll include the amphibians because nobody seems to care about only the amniotes and bump it up to tetrapods with TikTok. A word of caution here, Tiktaalik is not the last tetrapod common ancestor. In fact, most of the species that have actual specimens aren't. Because the last common ancestor is this one specific organism, and it's much, much more likely we hit one of these. But that's okay. If it's close evolutionarily, it's close morphology, usually. Well, if it's this close. In fact, Tiktaalik is not even the closest organism to the split. That would be the Befetids. And somewhat importantly, this is not the split. Let's discuss crown and stem groups. When a lineage breaks up, where do you define it? Does it start here or here? This difference may seem inconsequential, but you're forgetting the number of extinct species along the lineage. The crown group refers only to the extant species, while the stem group refers only to the extinct species. The clade starts at the break. So the split that defines it is the break off of Acanthostega and Ichthyostega, which are also the closest to our side of the break. Because its amniotes are by far the more derived group, a lot of what defines stem tetrapods is more or less amphibian-y. They don't lay amniotic eggs and lack scales, but there are some differences, mainly in terms of appearance, and that's largely a product of frogs being the most immediate example of an amphibian. Acanthostega more closely resembled a salamander. It had way more fingers than necessary, but this was cut down to 5 by the time we reached the crown group. It's believed Acanthostega still had gills. Amniotes, of course, lack gills altogether, and amphibians only have them as tadpoles. Some of them do have them as adults, but they had to actively go back and undo them. These also weren't fully external and had opercula. But overall, Acanthostega just doesn't do it for me. It doesn't make a name for itself. Also, it had too many fingers, clearly fake and AI-generated, ethics have gone out of the window, and I alone am here with nothing but time. So chordates are a bit far up the phylogenetic tree. Nevertheless, we do have a pretty good guess at what exactly was standing there. Pikaia gracilens, the slender one from Pika Peak, is close enough to the last chordate common ancestor for the purposes of this video. Chordates are defined by 5 very important characteristics. The notochord, hence the name. This was the first noticeable trait about Pikaia that made us first think to separate it from the worms. The dorsal hollow nerve cord, hence the name. Gill slits, though at this time they didn't house the gills, and an organ at the bottom of the throat that makes mucus, or at least space for such an organ to be in. It also kind of has the teeny tiniest little itty bitty beginnings of a tail, but it's not really recognized to be a post-anal tail, so that kind of clears it up. 4 out of 5 chordate synapomorphies, 4 out of 5 stars. The Urbilaterian, I've already mentioned in an earlier video, the common ancestor of all bilaterians, it was 3 balls that turns into a thing with a face. That's the gist of it. In its infancy, it develops as a ball of cells, which splits into 2 balls, one to form the outards and one to form the innards. This was the point when it became 3 balls, one to form the middlerds. As it grew, a hole formed in these balls, which would become the entrance to a blind gut with no anus. To the extent it had a brain, it was a collection of nerves near the sensory organs. Since it was symmetrical, it had a distinct left and right side, and its otherwise asymmetrical build meant it had a front and a back. The front developed into a head as organs that were dependent on position migrated to the front. In the last video, it got a C tier, but I'm willing to bump it up to a B. The Urmetazoan, similarly, is the ancestor of all animals. From sponges to birds to whales to bugs, the Urmetazoan was uniquely multicellular. But obviously it didn't invent that all on its own. Its neighbors, the fungi, are also multicellular, and more bizarre species like amoebas exhibit primitive multicellularism in the form of slime molds. But it was the metazoans that built up structures like an extracellular matrix and proteins to anchor the cells together. It also had macrosystems like the immune system. Sexual reproduction has flipped on and off since its evolution almost 2 billion years ago, and in metazoans it was turned on for good, well, to humans, some branches turned it back off. As usual, to get an idea of what it looked like, we need to see both sides of the split. Coanoflagellates, or larval sponges, tend to be the biggest comparisons. Honestly, it gets a bit more banal the more bizarre we go. Also, whenever we revert to plankton. But hey, it's the granddad. And finally, we're not just talking about animals, but fungi and amoebae and protists. So I say this organism was definitely played, not meta-defining, but you can probably find a slot for it in any deck. And we end where it all began. LUCA! The last universal common ancestor. LUCA is not the first creature that ever lived, that's FUCA, which is a bit harder as it gets into definitions of what exactly life even is, but LUCA is the last creature that wasn't either an archaean or a bacteria. The common ancestor of the enormous bioclade, Biota. This tree isn't quite right, but this is probably even more confusing, if accurate. Now, it's been postulated before that not all life shares a common ancestor. Mostly, this has to do with viruses being weird. Whether we want to classify viruses as life and whether they are unrelated, which is possible, is a large and biochemical debate. It's also not out of the question, as it's likely many other bioclades existed. But none of them made it to today. Now, only LUCA exists. LUCA was a single-celled prokaryote. It had RNA, DNA, and enzymes for translating and transcribing them. It had ribosomes to make proteins, as that's pretty much the only thing you can do with DNA. It had a simple cell membrane dividing it from the outside. And that's it. So in conclusion, it's not Adam and Steve, it's Adam and LUCA, and Adam is an alpha proteobacterium that gave rise to the mitochondria, and Satan is probably a virus. And who is Steve? I am Steve, Flint and Steel. Oh, these dudes? They're the villagers! They love crushing loaf. This is a crafting table. You ever wonder what happens when you mix hot lava and chicken? Big ol' red ones. An ender pearl. Boots of swiftness, diamond armor full set, and blades for days. Chicken jockey! I'm gonna cushion our fall with this water bucket! Release!